You are a thinker and a doer, creative and critical, a determined team player who dreams and builds a better future, our future. With your foot on the accelerator, you ensure progress, a movement that reaches further than the eye can see. Nothing throws you off course, but you always keep an open mind, because when nothing is certain, anything is possible. You persevere, no matter what, and push the boundaries, so the impossible becomes possible, because you know things can always be better, prettier, softer, more human, faster, smoother, more durable. You see things that aren't there yet. You make dreams come true.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome at our 2017 Dies Natalis. We wish to extend our welcome also to our Mayor John Joritsma and Mrs. Joritsma, to our guest speakers, Professor Bert van der Zwaan, Rector Magnificus of Utrecht University, and Professor Patrick Ebischer, former president of APFL, a partner university in our four Eurotech universities, which already now exist for 5 years. And to the other board member of our Dutch partner university of Utrecht, and that is Anton Pijpers. Welcome. Well, ladies and gentlemen, the question is, what in the world are we doing? That is a crucial question that every administrator should ask on a regular basis. And let me tell you what I think that the answer of the Eindhoven University of Technology is. What are we doing in this world? We make dreams come true. In 1956, the dreams belonged to our founders. And a world of technology rose from the ashes of World War II, a world of engineers, builders, and laboratory workers. Reality after 56 exceeded everyone's wildest imaginations. Look at the life of the 50s, or look at the life of today. The change is incredible. It's all mostly achieved through technology. Is that change coming to an end? Of course not. In the 50s, people dreamed of rebuilding and of recovery. Today, people dream of a better world, creating a better world, because this generation sees geopolitical tensions, sees a damaged planet, sees people who want to be healthy and active their entire life, and sees increasing mobility and insecurity, and a digital age with great impact and risks for the individual and for all of us. So what are we in Eindhoven doing for the world? We are working on a world where cars do not pollute the air, but clean it. We are working on a world where electricity doesn't go up in smoke, but is stored until the time you need it. Where tissues don't wither, but regenerate. And with a connectedness beyond what we can imagine today. Digital society will be everywhere and part of our daily life. We, at the TUE, are working towards innovation that will profoundly change our lives. And as we know, these changes will be stormy and disruptive. Profound changes always are. And today's engineers are well aware of that. Like never before, each engineer follows his and increasingly her sense of social responsibility. If life is changing in such a profound way, shouldn't the university change as well? Of course. We are not on an island. We are at the heart of society. Our educational approach will become more blended, far more digital. I see an increasing unbundling in our educational modules and more individual educational tracks. And online education will be everywhere, worldwide available. But we are also seeing other ways of approach of education. Hands-on education, multidisciplinary, team, and with more experimental component. In the future, I sincerely believe that half of our education at our campus will follow that approach. So very soon we will be starting implementing this new educational vision in the bachelor degree phase. And it will come to life in a one dedicated building, TUE Innovation Space. This will be the paragon of modern education, inspired by the way how our student teams work. Their unconventional approach and can-do mentality have lighted the way to this new initiative. We are supporting the people who always will work in multidisciplinary teams and who need to think in terms of integration, systems integration. You have to imagine in education that worldwide about 10 million people are looking for a good academic education outside their own countries. This interest from abroad means that we will become international anyhow. So in 2030, I expect that 30% of our staff and also 30% of our students come from outside the Netherlands. And by that time, we will have become a mid-sized university with around 15,000 on-campus students, and who knows how many online students. But however, doubling the number of students in only 10 years is an enormous growth. This growth makes us feel the limitations of our buildings, of our people, of our options. If the application for next year is again 15% or even 30% higher than this previous year, we will be forced to take appropriate measures, safeguarding the quality of our educational programs and reducing the workload of our people is our highest priority. And still it hurts, because the number of engineers that our labor market needs is twice as much as the supply. It would be a crying shame if we had to take a step back from meeting to that need. And there is another limitation that is taking our attention: the excessive workload of our staff. We as management have to act as a heat shield to safeguard them from pressure and rules from outside. And we also need to reduce inefficiency by cleaning up and simplifying internal processes. These are the concerns of today. In short, many things will change in our university, both now and in the future. But if it's up to me, some things will never change. We will continue to uphold our core values: personal contact, research and education in balance, to be the best at what we do, and training the engineers of the future on a compact campus where innovation starts and people matter. Of course, our core values are wonderful, but they aren't unique. So what distinguishes the TOE from other competitors? Because we need to be distinctive. Universities operate in a global market. What makes the TOE unique, and it gives us a leading international position, is our connection with the most innovative companies in this region and in this world. Many of these are here, around us, in our Brainport region. Because, ladies and gentlemen, Eindhoven and our region, they really matter. A city and a region that is becoming more lively and more international by the day. Our Brainport region is acknowledged now as the third economic region of the Netherlands. It even has a national action agenda. So now we all need, Mr. Mayor, other means so that we can get to work. Because TUE is a specialized university. It's solely focused on technology. This profile is supported by our basic science disciplines, our engineering disciplines, and as an extra dimension, disciplines that connect humans and technology. How are we contributing to a better world? First and first of all, training young, highly educated academic engineers. Second, by providing technical solutions to the global challenges like health, energy, and mobility. Our priority technologies are the complex molecular systems, the data sciences, high-tech systems, and photonics. And the engineers of the future that we train, they will have more than just an in-depth knowledge in a single field. They also will have a wider perspective of technology in a global societal context. So how will we achieve this? Our recent education reforms are a great start of that. But furthermore, we will invest in new ways that we always have been excelled at, connecting with industry. We will continue to stimulate fundamental research and science, and we will also encourage new models of applied science. Now, let me take you to the technology breakthroughs, because technology breakthroughs often start as an idea on a scratch pad jotted down by an university researcher. Some years later, these ideas end up as products in a commercial company. But between idea and product, there is the applied research, development, prototypes, industrialization. This middle phase is the most difficult one. This is known as the Valley of Death, at least here in the West. In Asia, they face this called the Bridge of Opportunities, because they view applied research as the phase that is best moment to make a difference. If you have the courage, if you really invest, and if you don't see failure as something shameful, the world is your oyster. So here in Eindhoven, we like that perspective. We can make the difference because we excel in that middle phase. That's what our predecessors did as well. We do that with multidisciplinary student teams, with PhD students, scientists, and company-based resident engineers. We will make the dreams come true of these young people in a creative environment. And the name of this model is TU Eindhoven Engine. Our dream is a multi-storied building with researchers from anywhere and using the right experimental setup to work in multidisciplinary teams with a wide range of finding the solutions for future, with an open community and with a maximum exchange of ideas. A real development phase. Ladies and gentlemen, in a minute, our keynote speakers will discuss the topic, will universities still be around in 2040? And after that, our young TUE scientist Ilja Vuts and two of her co-workers will take us to the wonderful world of hot proteins on cool crystals. What a beautiful hot proteins on a cool crystal. We are looking forward to that, Ilja. Because 60 years ago, we already had that engineering mindset. The motto in the region was, if we can think it, we can make it. And I would like to keep this mindset for the future and add a bit to it. Because in my speech, I touched several times the concept of space. I even mentioned heat shields. But since the 70s, there is a motto that attracts me ever since. The Trekkies among you may recognize this as the mission statement of the Starship Enterprise. To explore strange new worlds, to seek out new life and new civilization, and to boldly go where no one has gone before. The youngsters among us, they will help us to realize this mission in 2030 and 2040. Us elder will help guide their way. Thank you for your attention.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is a great honor for me to speak here today at the occasion of your Dies Natalis. This shows that the bond between Eindhoven University of Technology and Utrecht University is growing stronger and stronger, and in my speech I will point out why this is good. But mostly my speech will address the future of universities in general. I will try to pick up on a number of elements in the changing political and societal landscape that will affect higher education over the next 25 years. But first, I will address the university itself. What will change and why? Now, I already hear the criticasters, certainly at a technical university, saying predicting the future is totally impossible. But my answer to them is being totally unprepared for the future is downright stupid. So please bear with me and join me in this 20 minutes of looking into my crystal ball. From a traditional point of view, the first and possibly the most important role of the university is to educate young people. Providing a highly trained workforce in the form of a social elite has always been something that the university has done extremely well. From its founding until deep into the 17th century, for instance, the University of Salamanca was almost exclusively responsible for producing all of the key officials and administrators needed to serve the growing Kingdom of Spain and the Habsburg Empire. But that is all in the past. The question is, what kind of graduate will be needed in the future? Over the past decades, we have seen an increasing shift away from the provision of a broad college education at all universities. A growing number of voices argue in favor of using the university in a more targeted fashion as preparation for the labor market, also in view of the cost. What's certain, however, is that the labor market that we are used to, which has been employing graduates for centuries, is undergoing a truly fundamental transformation. Whereas for many years, employment could almost be taken for granted, nowadays we see a general contraction of the labor market, due, for instance, robotization, but more importantly, due to the sharp rise of supply of graduates worldwide, in particular in Asia, increasingly from very good technical universities, there's a growing competition whereby only the very best have a high chance of success. In such a situation, the extent to which a university program is tailored to rapidly changing demands from society is becoming increasingly important. In contrast to this, university curricula now tend to be supply-driven, that is, driven by academic traditions, in particular, and lecturers' interests, and I'm now looking at my colleagues over there, and research universities are not really demand-driven in the sense that they readily respond to demand of society. As a result, often little attention is paid to the so-called 21st century skills, like soft skills, leadership skills, but also to awareness of what's going on in society, general academic skills, Bildung, if you like. Yet these are precisely the skills that should characterize the curriculum of tomorrow. In many respects, emphasis in academic education still lies on the acquisition of knowledge. But in future, knowledge will be available everywhere around us, in the cloud. Hence, the role of the university graduate will shift from gathering and generating knowledge to using it, and above all, using it in a truly creative fashion. Asking good questions is still, but maybe even increasingly so, more important than knowing facts. Also, the technical university needs to be more student-centric, more geared towards customized learning, more towards creativity in order to survive. In addition to education, there's evidently research as a second important dimension to the knowledge role of universities. Since the Enlightenment, the ideal of knowledge, the gathering of knowledge for knowledge's sake, has come to lie at the very heart of the university. That idea gradually developed that production of knowledge is always meaningful, even if it results in a huge number of articles that no one reads or cites. In the coming years, it is essential that this view evolves into a different concept, namely that the university is concerned with something more like the production of wisdom. analogous to the way in which the university's contribution should be measured in terms of meaningful impact, and not only in the economic sense, knowledge should be valued to the extent that it functions in the context of a really pressing question, and the degree to which it provides a broadly applicable answer. An excellent university, in my mind, in the future, is not a university that has the highest production of papers, but a university that combines really asking really profound questions with contributing to society in equal measure. In a critical environment like yours, words as meaningful and wisdom soon provoke follow-up questions. I see it in some of the faces. For behind such terms lies a whole range of potential meanings and implications. Instead, however, of defining these immediately, in the new form of the university, this meaning should be discovered in discussions with the university community, in debate with societal actors. And this search, I believe, is important because it will allow us to identify precisely which pressing questions we are facing and how knowledge might contribute to these. But it will also be the search to discover when knowledge becomes wisdom, thus when it becomes a solution that really enriches people's lives. Even when I have no time is the most heard expression in our universities, it is time well spent to debate our mission. So far, I've talked about some aspects of the changing university. Let me now briefly touch upon the changing landscape in which the university will operate or might be operating in the next coming 25 years. And no doubt, higher education will change profoundly. Teaching will transform due to digitalization, customized teaching programs, and the rapidly increasing importance of obtaining course certificates over the degree will prevail. Research will move more and more towards interdisciplinary questions, like we just heard. Global cooperation supported by IT will be the norm. And research facilities will be so costly that they will be out of reach for many universities. In view of digital and lifelong learning, universities will have to fight to keep the form of the campus university. Yet, we should realize that precisely the research and its facilities are legitimizing a campus, also for students, as long as research forms a substantial part of the curriculum. And that implies that teaching and research, as we just saw, and I agree, should be really intimately connected in order to survive as a campus university. This and much more will deeply affect the traditional university. But while we as universities are grappling with all these changes, we should not lose sight of societal undercurrents affecting the very foundation of the university. In 1852, Newman wrote, and I quote, "A university is a place where the students come from every quarter for every kind of knowledge, in which the intellect may safely range and speculate. It is a place where inquiry is pushed forward, discoveries perfected and verified, and error exposed by the collision of mind with mind and knowledge with knowledge." University has built upon this idealistic mission for many years. On top of that, over the past several decades, the university has been forced into the role of innovator, provider of skilled personnel, and attractor of international talent and business investments. But now society increasingly demands more influence on the scientific agenda setting, requires open science, and urges the university to think more about its impact and meaningful contributions rather than about creation of economic value. Underlying this trend is the sense of a growing divide in society. Statistics support the emergence of such a social divide, not only in the US, but also in Europe and also here in the Netherlands. Education is increasingly becoming a characteristic of social class. Worldwide, there's now an educated elite which benefits from rising global prosperity. However, a growing proportion of the population, also in Europe, is faced with a decline in opportunities on the labor market. The negative sentiment of the so-called angry white man who's losing out or feels he's losing out to globalization and the open borders that promote international trade has grown over the past few years. This resulted, amongst others, in the dissatisfaction that colored the elections in the US, led to the British electorate turning its back against the European Union, and continued to dominate polls, referenda and elections in the Netherlands, Italy, France, and Germany. In this context, Stephen Hawking wrote a beautiful letter to The Guardian last year with the title, "This is the most dangerous time for our planet." He starts his letter with, and I quote, "I've lived my life in an extraordinary privileged bubble," indicating the way universities still tend to operate in relative isolation. And then he continues, "Taken together, we are living in a world of widening, not diminishing, financial inequality, in which many people can see not just their standard of living, but their ability to earn a living at all, disappearing." And finally, perhaps the most disturbing undercurrent which is around is that facts hardly play a role anymore, and that the societal debate is primarily governed by emotions. This is evident in people's reactions on social media, where facts are no longer recognized as facts and instead dismissed as mere opinions. And here, President Trump set a new precedent by stating that, I quote, "A lot of people feel it wasn't a proper certificate," after President Obama released his birth certificate. This profoundly changing landscape that will surround the university imposes another set of changes next to those imposed by teaching and research. Although some of us mourn the fact that the university has left its ivory tower as described by Newman, in my mind, universities should go further and take advantage of this in the coming years in order to become more visible and play a more significant role in society. This could range from addressing major societal problems to providing knowledge for better informed politics, rather than withdrawing into its old role. An engaged civic university should be vocal and take up a position in the public debate. This would certainly help to legitimize the university and create new carrying capacity in society to sufficiently fund higher education from public sources, instead of leaving it to private funding through sky-high tuition fees. Access to higher education in the coming years, now increasingly prevented by high costs, is crucial for a future society without a social divide, which only spells trouble. Higher education for as many as possible is a key feature for a prosperous and stable future society. But most of all, in this so-called post-fact era, the university needs to regain its role as speaker of truth. In an age ruled by the wisdom of the crowd, reliable institutions are crucial. The university should be such an independent authority, shown clear ways out of complex problems. So far, I've outlined the changed mission of the university in terms of research and teaching. And in the second part of my speech, so you know now where I am in my speech, I've also shown you the changed landscape, which we probably need to operate. Let me finish by addressing what this all means for our mindset, our own mindset, as faculty of a university, as students. In my view, and I've already said it, too often the university takes a passive role, insufficiently anticipating the changing societal needs. Knowledge for knowledge's sake still dominates too much. I already mentioned that the university needs to play a larger role in society in order to retain support. And the fringe benefit of that is that for the university, by doing so, it will become part of a broader system in which knowledge circulates and thereby brings higher returns. That could even lead to universities, as Leary universities have been doing so, to associations with large organizations such as the United Nations, or parts of them, such as the Food and Agriculture Organization, or with NGOs, regional governments, so as to provide the large programs which are running there with the essential knowledge, as is done, by the way, quite successfully in this region. I think it's an example. Ideally, research programs should focus on the cutting edge of major societal and fundamental questions, which require input from many disciplines. Interdisciplinary research will therefore inevitably play a large role. Teaching needs to shift from solely disciplinary education to training of students as T-shaped professionals. Students are thus prepared for their future roles, not only as university graduates in all kinds of professions, but also for a considerable number of graduates as leaders in society. In short, we should learn to consider our scientific problems in a wider context. For instance, in your case, you should be more aware of the fact that most problems in society and science are not of a strictly technical nature. I know that I'm now touching upon a potential sore spot, but let me explain using climate change, that's my profession, as an example. I'm on safe ground here, so I know, don't make mistakes. From the point of view of science, we are very far advanced in understanding and predicting the climate system. We know that if we persist in our present behavior, we will certainly surpass the critical boundaries of two degrees warming of the Earth. So the problem is one of governance and social arrangements more than a technical issue. However, technical solutions as alternative energy sources can help to implement pathways to sustainability and facilitate in finding a way out. But then again, extremely viable technical solutions like use of the deeper underground for storage of heat or carbon dioxide might immediately be confronted with strongly opposing societal views, which need input from governance and social sciences to overcome. This brief example shows that it is absolutely inevitable that technical universities join forces with disciplines from the sciences and social sciences and humanities, but also vice versa, that comprehensive universities like mine team up with technical ones in order to arrive at successful solutions. But this brings more than only short-term success. I really believe that the combination of disciplines and the recombination in new convergences facilitated in the future by powerful IT could lead to a new renaissance of the literal meaning of the word. Our mindset should change in order to recognize the opportunities that new configurations will bring. The collaboration between Eindhoven and Utrecht universities is exactly doing that. And I say with some urgency, if we want to remain both the excellent universities that we are today, then such collaboration is of the essence to maintain our prominent positions in an international perspective, where elsewhere consortia like ours are formed with great speed and great success. However, while doing all this, and while preparing our universities to the new reality of the future, let's keep keen eyesight on the world around us. Let's engage in a deeper dialogue about future and social needs, with new paths for cooperation. Our mission as modern research intensive universities, however, is beyond even that. We should realize that science is a powerful glue that keeps society together, which straddles boundaries in a crumbling political system. Science is the only way forward to solve fundamental societal issues. That should be our message to society, with open science as an excellent tool of showing what we have to offer. The universitas, the university community, exists already for over 800 years. And from my perspective, it is the most hopeful community that has ever existed, with exciting intellectual capacity and an enormous power to adapt. It will certainly exist in 2040, but in a totally different shape and form. Be prepared for it. Ik heb gezegd.
Ladies and gentlemen, first I'd like to thank you for the honor that is given to me to speak today for your dies natalis. Chairman Jan Mengles gave me an assignment. I think, you know, Rector Magnificus from Utrecht beautifully described, in fact, the challenges that are being faced by university, by higher education. I was given a more down-to-earth question, which is how are we going to finance them? So I guess in this environment, we all agreed that we would like to exist in the future. The question is, how are we going to do this? I'm going to give this from the perspective of the university that I had the pleasure and honor to lead for 17 years, which is EPFL, a very young university created in 1969. So we're not even yet 50 years old. However, we, as you can see, we have a location which is not bad to some extent, but also that gives, and I think Utrecht is and Eindhoven in the same position, we are a young university. And I think, to some extent, it's going to be easier to adapt when you're not loaded with history. Now, let me tell you what, you know, all the chance is all about. And I think there was a very interesting article from The Economist entitled Creative Destruction, Reinventing the University. What this article said is that the current situation is that we see rising tuition fees, change in demand, disruptive technologies. Now, just to give you one example, today, the debt in the US linked to a student fellowship is $1.2 trillion. Ladies and gentlemen, this is unsustainable. We have to find new ways to it because, as the Rector Magnificus said, we will limit the entrance to the people that can afford, and this goes utterly against all our tradition. They also said something interesting. They said within 15 years, more than half of the universities will be bankrupt. Now, they say this with the US perspective, but I think we're not far from this if we don't change something in our model. And the last thing, which is we all agree, it's not something that we do at one point of our life, but we have to do it all along. So lifelong learning, a need to re-educate the workforce. Now, what I would say is we will change the topology of universities. On one side, you will have an increased number of teaching colleges that will blend online with residential experience. And I think that some universities will have, by necessity, to decrease, if not stop, their research component. And that's going to be the shocking part for a lot of us. The second is we will see development of online-based lifelong learning institutions by themselves. And I think, to some extent, the GAFAs, the Googles, will challenge us because they have the capabilities through online technologies to disseminate knowledge. I think this is the first time that, to some extent, companies may challenge us in the way we're going to educate the workforce. The last and most important for us today is I think there will be fewer but bigger world-class research universities. And probably in every country, you could have one or two, and probably it's going to be difficult to have more. Why? Because research is expensive, and as Max Planck said, each increment of science is more costly than the previous one. And the question is, how are you going to go about? So to some extent, the key issue is the financial sustainability of research university. That's the purpose of today. I think what we're going to say is that universities have become a major actor in the development of knowledge-based economy. And that's why people start to be interested by university. The second thing is that the financing from the public sector is not able to keep pace with the growing needs of cost of modern science in higher education. Looking at the budget of our states, being town, states in general, it's very clear that it's going to be difficult for them. So to some extent, universities have to diversify their source of income. And of course, the easy way is the tuition. But as the US model has shown, it is not the way. We cannot ask people to finance research. It is the problem in the United States. Tuition does not only cover the education, but in fact, tuition, you know, supports research. And this is unsustainable. And I like this kind of map, to be honest. I'm not saying maybe there's a middle ground and there are students here, but I don't think that we should have zero, but certainly we should not go down the path that the US has done. We should keep affordable tuition. So I think the future does not lay in tuition increase. So those are five items that I would like just to say a couple of words about. The first thing and most important is increase competitive research funding. But the second part of the sentence is even more important, carrying overheads. Because research has a cost. And when you get a grant, it doesn't cover the full cost. So if the states and so on do not understand, or if the foundation, the charitable foundation, don't understand that you have to accept the overhead, you will not allow a sustainable system to develop. Now this is just to show you the kind of a history of grants, competitive grant over time at EPFL, and you can see that around 2005 and so on, you see a major increase. Now why is that so? Because you know we've changed the way we function, we recruited what we think top people from all over the world, and if you have great faculty, they're going to be fantastic at getting the grants. So if they do not carry overhead, you're going to be in deep trouble. So it is the worst thing is to have great faculty with zero overhead, which is absurd to some extent. If you want to have a merit-based system, you have to carry the overheads that are really. Now, you can link, of course, this became something very important for Europe, the ERC grant, the European Research Council grants. I'm saying, of course, this because the EPFL did okay. But not only. I think the important thing that you get is this message is who is there? The UK, Switzerland, and Israel. Where is the rest of Europe? Why don't we see the French? Why don't we see the German universities? This is something of great question. Now, there are a lot of different answers and solutions. But for me, this is important. You have to have a better repartition. Those countries have to develop some elite universities. So we've kept a very good general education. But I make the point that we missed a couple of elite universities. Why the state is so productive? Why do you have the Silicon Valleys? It's because you have the Stanford, because you have the Berkeleys, or if you're Route 128, because you have MITs, the Harvards. Europe needs those elite universities. Now, to do this, you need to carry the overhead and the cost of really running your operation. Otherwise, you give this to the states, and the states will not be able to follow over time. And this is the whole problem. You see, the Swiss National Foundation gives only a 15%. In the states, it's more 60%. Now, interestingly, Rector Benavides referred to Donald Trump. His first statement around the university, he wants to cut the overheads. Ladies and gentlemen, this is an opportunity for Europe. It is an opportunity to bring back people to Europe, which I think, and of course, a lot of Europeans are in the United States, are in fact making this system functioning. Now, we have to convince our national agencies to increase the tuition. You look at industry is making, and I think the 60% is probably the right number. Europe is still too low. And charities, and I love charities, but if they do not pay overhead, they're distorting the system, and I'll come back to that. The second thing is, of course, everybody speaks about innovation-related income. License fees, startup, and they say, if you have a great startup, I can finance the university. Let me just show you, you will not see the detail, but you see the red is the research money, and the blue is the income. Even in the United States, you will not be able to fund your direct research by licensing. You will have some nice, what I call icing on the cake. But it is impossible, even for the Stanfords, to function through income related to licensing. However, what is important? Licensing is an engine for partnership, innovation, regional economic development. That's where we are. The important is the new company that are created, the new Philips that will be created in this area, and they will be created only because you have top research universities in the region you live in. And that's why they're important. So what is important? You have also done, we have done an EPFL Science Park, for example. We have about 150 startups developing, but more important, the large companies that came here, they're coming because they want to smell. They're always concerned about the Kodak syndrome, suddenly a new technology disrupting the business. That's where the big companies, so it's an ecosystem that you build with the small fish, the research, and then you go on. And then you create 2,000 job values, and by the way, if you do this even through PPP, it's a profitable operation just to rent the space. That's where I think we should do more. And now you can see the venture capital coming, that's just for EPFL. You saw in 2000, a couple of million. Last year, there are variation, but last year, you know, our companies have attracted 400 million of venture cap in a single year. This is close to half the budget for the university. It doesn't come directly, but it creates the economic development around your institution. Continuous education. And I think we have to get out. We will continue to do bachelor, master's, PhD, but there's something new coming, this lifelong learning. So we've created an extension school. What is an extension school? It's a new forms of lifelong learning, blending again online and with residential. We create a new certification, because if people are behind a computer, you don't know if they have a degree. I don't care if they succeed in our courses. The important thing is they have the brain power to succeed. So we created this no prerequisite, nanogrees offered on these famous MOOCs, massive open online courses, and we see companies now giving us vouchers to their employers to take our courses. And I just, an example, Scala Experience. This is Professor Mata Oderski. He's one of our top computer scientists. He's the father of a language called Scala, which is one of the very popular programming language. Now, if you want to learn to program in Scala, why don't you do it directly from the father's Scala instead of the father of the son of the son of the son? And I think this going directly, so he put online these courses, and the first time we didn't do anything. He had 50,000 students, but more interestingly, 10,000 took the exam. Ladies and gentlemen, this is more than an entire academic life in one single course. Now, he has graduated more than 100,000. Now, if you put just 100,000 by 100 francs for a certification, you've resolved partially your financial problems. So I think, you know, either we leave this to the GAFAs, to new institution, or we capture this. And this is just a map to see those are our students, online students at EPFL. What is, I think, is nice is you see the United States. Who would have thought that the little school from Lausanne would have such an impact in the United States? Because you have the right professors. So not every field is amenable, but some of them are. You see Korea, more the south than the north, as you can see, that are in fact taking our courses. But this is, and today we have more than 1.6 million students abroad, online. And I think this is a changing game. Last two items, develop creative ways of financing infrastructure. I saw a beautiful building. I wish you all the luck to find the finance to build it, because I truly believe that this is important to create this new spirit. That's what we did also at EPFL. You see a couple of buildings, for example, a Congress Center, the Innovation Park, our new learning center, a hotel, student housing. This was not done on our own money, but we went to find money outside. How does this distribute it? Or maybe just before, this is one of the buildings, of course. You need an iconic building. We're young school, so we created it. We had 17 libraries, put them all in one, create this building, which is open 24 hours a day. You know, Saturday and Sunday, it's full. It's a student life, really. Interestingly, this was supported by Rolex, Credit Suisse, Novartis, Nestle, Sigma, Logitech, Bouygues, a lot of the Swiss companies that have participated. So about half the building was paid, in fact, directly. It was designed by Sanash. They got the Pritzker Award, which is the Nobel Prize of Architecture, for this building. But now when you look at how much money we've put, so you could see that we invested close to 750 million Swiss francs, which is about the same in euros, over the last 10 years. Where did the money come from? 66 public-private partnership. If you build housing and so on, you will not do this on your own dime. 25% sponsors, philanthropy, only 9% of our money went into buildings. And I think this is a shift that you have to do so that you could liberate money for what you really want to do, which is the research and the education. Last thing, fundraising, buildings, chairs, scholarships. Of course, we have to create endowments. That's what we missed most in Europe. Now, of course, we know the numbers in the United States. The Harvard, $35 billion, okay? So if you have a 10% return, which is what they tend to have, that's okay. That allows you. But it took them a long time to do it. So you will not. And you could see that there are very few. And very quickly, you get, it's nice if you have $2.1 billion for Boston College, but you're not in the same league. Now, in Europe, only Cambridge and Oxford and Copenhagen University have won over $1 billion. So where are the others? We don't. So I think we're lacking behind. UK is pioneering. And now, of course, Rector Magnificus, chairman, that's your job. It is our job to go and find, okay? And I think this is very important. And we have to engage. A US university president spends about 50% of his time fundraising. So somebody has to do. It doesn't grow on trees. It needs hard work. But I found it quite fun. Now, the good thing is we see more and more people giving big gifts. So this is a couple of examples. John Paulson gave $400 million gift once, in one shot. Ted Stanley, $650 million. We're getting close to the $1 billion gift. Now, we were a little more modest, but still, we got somebody called Hans-Jörg Wiss that gave us $100 million. It's about to double the numbers. So those people, this is feasible in Europe. And I think this is the kind of thing we need to do. Now, there is a cost, there's a price to it, and I wrote a couple of years ago an article in Nature saying that, in fact, philanthropists should pay their fair share of research cost. This is all fine as long as they will support the overhead. You cannot. Otherwise, the danger is that certain discipline gets more, like life science. Who will pay the architecture? Who will pay the archaeology? It is very important to have. So charity has a cost, and it is the indirect cost. So big gift, I think, could unbalance financial allocation within the institution. So you have to be sure that when you accept them, they are part of your strategy. And you should not let the university be driven by the gifts, but you have to anticipate the areas where you want to be in. And now, just to give you an example, so we started at 50 years, now 50 million, now we're about 100 million per year at APFL, which is about 10% of our budget. So the good news, it's feasible. The bad news is when you look at Stanford raised $1 billion a year. So we still have a long way to go, but I think it is feasible. Why is it feasible? Because people want to give back to society. And as there is more and more new money, you feel terrible. And when you say, what are you going to do? You, when you bought your jets, whatever, you get bored to death. We are the best investment, I think, because we support the most noble thing of mankind, which is knowledge and transmission of knowledge. And I think that's why it is so important. Now, when you see where does this thing, you see chairs, research project, buildings, scholarships, you name it. And I will finish this. Of course, there is a boundary. To come back to, will university exist? Yes, and the research university will exist. But you have to realize that you will have to have a certain budget to be competitive. And the overall, when you look at the top of rankings, you see 10,000 outstanding students, 50% graduate, 500 top labs, and a budget of $1 billion. Those are, when you look at the rankings, the thing. You have to have also a unique USP. We went with the, what we call info-nano-biocognitive convergence between information technology, nanotechnology, biotechnology, and cognitive science. I feel that there's fantastic opportunities, for example, to bring back the humanities and the hard science with through computer to digital to talk to each other so as to become, again, a comprehensive. Often we're comprehensive by name, but not by action. And I think we have to, you know, break those boundaries. And I think the digital skills are the most important. So for example, we also have a project with human brain, you know, all those kind of things that are very interesting. So where are we? Just to give you an example for EPFL today, it's a bit 10,000 students. But what is interesting is close to 1.7 million students online. We recruit every week more students online than we have on campus. So that's the real issue of tomorrow. And why are we letting the Americans take the market? Why are we always skeptical? Why are we not embracing those new fields? That's the thing that sometimes puzzles me with Europe. We have the capacity, we have the knowledge, we just have to be sufficiently bold to get there. We have about 390 labs, so my successor has still some work to increase the number of labs. Of course, this is important. The research is to give you, we're about 180 ERC grants and a Fed flagship, which is a 1 billion grant, which is the kind of thing that you want. So if you have great professors, they will be able to get 400 million in venture cap and the budget that we just reached now of a billion. Now, our budget was 420 million, which is close to your budget today, in 2000. So you can grow if you have the ambition. And now, of course, if you do this, it has an impact on rankings. So we all hate rankings, rectors, president, but we have to live with them to some extent. And they're a reflection of something. And your capacity to attract the best students, because at the end, a university is just a gathering of great brains that are enjoying to be together for the good of mankind. And now, of course, you're always number one in something in life, so we are number one in the Times Higher Education of the last 50 years, but we're going to be kicked out in 3 years of this ranking because we will be 50 years, so we still have a little work to do to gain. Now, I'm sorry because I had to speak about financing. This is the worst thing because we're not there to do that. But without the financing, of course, you can have the nicest dream, but they will not become a reality. But let's not forget our raison d'être. And that was beautifully spoken by the previous speaker. And I think I like this quote of Donald Kennedy in his book called Academic Duty. And he said something that I could really feel very profoundly. He said, the university is an institution that exists to advance culture both by acquiring more knowledge and by disseminating received knowledge in ways that inspire young people to use it both creatively and constructively. And ladies and gentlemen, I know no other organization that could do this than the universities. So I believe in the future of university, but we have to be realistic and we have to find the finance to support this dream. Thank you for your attention.
cups on those days. Whiskers on kittens, bright copper kettles and warm laments. Brown paper packages tied up with strings. These are a few of my favorite things. Cream-colored ponies, crisp apple strudel, doorbells and sleigh bells, schnitzel and noodle. Wild geese that fly with the moon on their wings. These are a few of my favorite things. Girls in white dresses, blue satin sashes, snowflakes that fall on my nose and eyelashes, silver white winters that melt into spring. These are a few of my favorite things.
When the dawn lights, when the bee stings, when I'm feeling sad,
I simply remember my favorite things, and then I don't feel so bad. La la la, la la la.
Gentlemen, I'd like to start by saying that it's a great pleasure and an honor for me, for Phil, and for Emma to be here today and to give you an insight into our science. We study self-organized and bio-inspired materials out of a fundamental interest and to develop a knowledge base for future innovations. We build these materials that are complex and hierarchical out of small elements, all smaller than the size of a pinhead, based on lessons learned from nature. We design these systems to have a specific function, to communicate with and to adapt to their environment. And ultimately, what we aim to do is to make materials that make themselves. Now, clearly, there's no time today to tell you all about what we do, so let us give you just a few examples. 6 years ago, when I was doing a postdoctoral research period in Switzerland, I read an article in a journal, JAX, on ice-binding proteins in snow flea, and I was fascinated. Freezing is lethal to most organisms, and it's detrimental to soft materials. And yet, nature has come up with a clever way, a smart way, to deal with harsh living conditions, as in the Antarctic. Without ice-binding proteins that these fishes living in the Antarctic produce, they would freeze to death. But thanks to these proteins, they do not. And that is because these proteins stick to tiny ice crystals circulating in their bloodstream, and they block further growth. What we do is we study these ice-binding proteins, how these hot proteins do their magic. And based on these insights, we developed bio-inspired polymeric antifreezes. But wait a minute, you say, isn't there an insect that is actually able to survive at very low temperatures, at minus 272 degrees? You're right, indeed, that's the tardigrade. And you imagine, didn't I hear about this frog that can actually survive freezing and thawing? Yes, indeed, you're right, that's true. That's an Alaskan wood frog. Why then do we take inspiration from polar fishes, from ice-binding proteins, and not from these creatures? Well, that's simple. That is because to not freeze, but to solidify, to vitrify, and to remain alive, what these creatures do is they produce large amounts of sugars. And that's not what we want to do, because what we want to do is to have less sugar, not more, in our frozen products. What we want to have is not more additives, but less additives in our cryopreservation media. And so we study ice-binding proteins that block further growth of ice crystals, that inhibit ice recrystallization, because these are 400 times more effective than sugars and common antifreezes like ethanol. And so we are inspired by these ice-binding proteins, and we develop artificial mimics to block freeze damage in a whole range of applications. What then is the big challenge in this field? Well, that's simple. Imagine that you want to design a beautiful reactor, as the one shown here behind me, to use sunlight for chemical transformations, but you can't see it. Imagine that you want to coat an ice crystal, but you can't hold it. Imagine that you want to fold a piece of paper, but you can't touch it. That is the big challenge. We design, we build, and we characterize the function and the structure of soft materials without touching any of the essential components. That is self-assembly. That is self-organization. Nature masters it, as you can see behind me in this animation of the life of a cell. Imagine that one day we can do it as well as nature does it, or even better. Self-assembly, it's an area of research and technology where TUE stands out, because we have what it takes. We have the chemistry to make the materials. We have the physics to measure and model what's invisible to the naked eye, and we have the engineering to put it to use. Now, clearly, for this field of research, high-tech infrastructure is important, because without it, simply, we can't see what's in the materials that we make, and there is so much to be discovered. Let me give you a few examples. The unique X-ray infrastructure that we have here at the TUE enables us to illuminate chemical assembly pathways and measure the structure and the dynamics of proteins and their complexes, as Phil will talk about in a minute. Our microscopy facilities are superb. We have, for example, super-resolution microscopy. And because of that, we can study the molecular makeup and the evolution of soft colloidal materials, a topic that Emma is passionate about. Recently, we developed a new tool for super-resolution microscopy that we coined iPaint. And with it, we can visualize, for the very first time, in situ within the organic solvents, directly, the structure of dynamic plastics, but also individual nanoparticles within a much larger cluster. And so with the best tools currently available to us, what we can do is we can look at the fast motion of large colloids. We can probe the slow dynamics of polymers. And we can measure the mechanics of stressed cells, but we are in trouble when small things move very fast. That's our next stop. That is why we and others develop new technologies, new instruments, to see what we can't see yet and to do what we cannot do yet. So why do we do all of this? What drives us? Well, that's simple. That's curiosity. We do this out of curiosity, out of an interest in the world around us, because we want to know how it works, we want to maintain it, we want to repair it, and we would like to make it even better. I like to think that is our impact. That's the impact of our science and our education and our mission, to train the next generation of engineers to explore and to develop, out of curiosity, novel routes for future sustainable technologies for everyone. And so we study the self-assembly of precision polymers because we are fascinated by these chemicals. And one day, this helps to improve production processes of high-quality waterborne paints. And so we study ice-binding proteins because we simply want to know how they work. And one day, analogs based on the working mechanism of these proteins can help to prolong the storage of full organs from transplantation. Notice how I use the word we, the royal we, in my speech. And that is, of course, because I don't do this work alone. I do it with my group. I do it with my colleagues and friends at the Institute for Complex Molecular Systems, the ICMS, with colleagues at the Department of Chemistry and Chemical Engineering, other colleagues in the TUE, collaborators within the Netherlands and abroad. And that is because science is collaborative. It is multidisciplinary and it is international. Science means pushing borders and crossing borders. And so what I would like to do is to give the stage to two very talented scientists in my group who have literally crossed borders to be here. And I would like to give them the floor to talk about their science, their passion, and their ambitions for the future. Phil, please come forward.
Okay, thank you. Okay. Thank you, Ilea. Actually, I have to start with a confession. Having grown up in China and studying in Canada, I did not know that TUE existed around 3 years ago. All I knew about Eindhoven was Philips and, of course, the PSV. But in the final year of my PhD in 2015, I had a chance to visit the TUE to work with Ilya on a project I'll describe in a minute. But I was instantly blown away by the innovative, multidisciplinary, and also collaborative research that's being carried out at the TUE. And the facilities here are absolutely world-class. So today, I'm really glad that I can come back to the TUE as a postdoc, because I believe the TUE is not only a place that I can do cutting-edge research, but also a place where I can apply the knowledge I learned to industry and medical settings for the benefit of the general public. So the Antarctica is a cold place. As we can imagine, the landscape should look something like this. But have you imagined that small organisms also live in this harsh environment? like these algae, live underneath the ice cover of the lake water. They'll need to stay near the top of the water where there's light so that they can survive in a process called photosynthesis. But unfortunately, they cannot move up there by themselves. Our research shows these small rod-shaped bacteria actually swim to the algae and bring them up the water and then stick them to ice, where there's enough light for the algae to perform photosynthesis to produce oxygen, where the bacteria can, in exchange, receive the oxygen to survive. You can imagine over time, a large community of these microorganisms will thrive even underneath the ice. And all these interactions are mediated by these long arms of the bacteria. So I have been studying these long arms of bacteria, which are also called adhesins. The adhesins are the largest proteins produced by the bacteria, so that they're very, very challenging to study. But thanks to the X-ray and the super resolution microscopy methods described by Ilya, now we can see all parts of the adhesin in great detail for the first time. These include the hand of the adhesin that binds to ice, as well as the sugar and the protein molecules on the algae cell surfaces, and the extremely long arm of these adhesins that projects or help the hand reach out to ice, as well as other targets. And finally, we have the base that really anchors this large hand and arms to the bacterial body, which is its membrane. So you might say, this all seems very cool, but what do small bacteria from the Antarctica have anything to do with us, with our everyday life? In fact, these adhesins are found in almost all bacteria, including human pathogens. Here I show an example of the bacteria that caused the disease cholera. As you can see, the network of the adhesins help the bacteria stick very tightly to the human intestine cells, where they can cause infection. So bacterial resistance to antibiotics has become a substantial threat to the global population in recent years, and we are looking for alternative ways to treat infections. With our study on ice adhesin, now we think we can specifically block the stickiness of bacteria to various surfaces. And with these pathogens more easily to let go, we think we can start to think and develop new strategies to treat infections without the excessive use of antibiotics. Thank you very much. And I'd like to give the floor to Emma. There you go.
Thank you, Phil. I recently completed my first year of my PhD here in Eindhoven. I chose to come to the TUE from my home country of Australia for a number of reasons. The strong collaboration between research disciplines, the collaboration between science and industry, as well as the aim for high impact research. When I started studying chemistry in high school, I was fascinated by the way that the fundamental laws of physics and chemistry could be used to describe the world around me. Everything around us is made up from smaller materials, such as an atom is made from protons, neutrons, and electrons. On a slightly larger scale, but still 1,000 times smaller than the width of a hair, particles arranged in specific ways can give objects with amazing properties, like structural color, which gives this vibrant blue color to the wings of a morpho butterfly. The same physical law can be applied to an opal, which consists of tightly packed silica spheres, the same material that these beautiful windows are made from. Structural materials can be used for countless applications, such as photonics, high-functioning coatings and paints, as well as functional systems, such as in drug delivery. By mimicking nature, we can control the way that particles assemble, and in this way, we can control the formation and properties of the final object. The more layers of control that we put into a system, the more control we have over the properties. In our lab, we use both light and temperature to control the assembly of silica spheres. And to do this, we attach small molecules to the surface that are capable of self-assembling. These small molecules act as linkers, or hands and arms, to use Phil's analogy, to bind the particles together. However, at first, the linkers are protected, and so particles can come into contact but are free to move away again. When we use light to deprotect the linker, the particles can move close and then they are attached, and they can no longer freely move. And so assembly is initiated. We can also use temperature to control the dynamics of the assembly. And in this way, we can form precise aggregates. The responsive nature of these particles has led me to think of some possible future applications. Something that I'm very inspired by is targeted drug delivery. And the nanoparticles have great potential in this area. They can be used to better encapsulate, transport, and release drugs in the body. An interesting example of nanoparticles as drug carriers is shear-induced release, where well-defined aggregates, such as those I described earlier, can be used to encapsulate drugs and carefully release them in the body. The narrowing of blood vessels occurs when platelets adhere to the surface, and this can lead to obstruction and blood clots of important vessels. However, the narrowing also offers a natural mechanism for the delivery of drugs by forced disassembly of these aggregates, releasing the cargo that they carry. Currently, nanoparticles that are used for drug delivery are often associated with negative side effects. What if, by using fundamental colloidal science, we could engineer a robust platform that the effects and dynamics in the body are well quantified, and then apply these to a wide range of cases? I hope to use my training and knowledge in the future to make a significant contribution to this field. Thank you.
And so, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to conclude by saying we came to TUE because we were inspired, and now we hope that we can be a source of inspiration to others, telling our students to dream big, to dare to be different, to go out there and to do it. Thank you very much.
It's difficult to describe talent, but if you see it, you know it. Ilya, Emma, Phil, thank you very much. I very much enjoyed it. We now come to the degree ceremony of Professor Lars Argent. The honorable doctorate is awarded for his pioneering work in the field of algorithms, for massive data, and for his outstanding achievements in the design of IO-efficient data structures. I invite Professor Arge, Professor De Berg, and the Dean of the Department of Mathematics and Computer Science, Professor De Keen, to come forward. Through the power invested in us by law, the doctorate board of the Eindhoven University of Technology has decided to confer the degree of Doctor Honoris Causa to Professor Lars Allen Arge of Aarhus University, Denmark, and to appoint as honorary doctor, promoter, Professor Mark de Berg, Professor of Algorithms, and I request the honorary promoter to perform the duties entrusted to him.
Dear colleagues, dear students, ladies and gentlemen,
Lars Ark is a prominent researcher, an inspiring research leader, the founder of a successful company, and one of my favorite colleagues. It is therefore not only a great honor for this university to award him an honorary doctorate, but it's also a great pleasure for me personally to serve as his honorary promoter. People often say that when you buy a house, three things are important: location, location, location. Similarly, in scientific research and in decision making, three things are very important: data, data, and data. Thus, huge amounts of data are being collected nowadays by scientists, by companies, and by governments. This results in massive data sets that need to be stored and analyzed. Data sets that are so huge that they do not fit into a computer's internal memory. The time an algorithm needs to analyze such data sets then does not depends on the number of IOs it does, that is, on the time it spends moving data back and forth between external and internal memory. Unfortunately, traditional algorithms theory completely ignores this issue. What we need in this era of big data is a new theory, a theory of IO-efficient algorithms. Lars already realized this more than 25 years ago when he did his PhD in Denmark, and he became one of the pioneers in this area. The IO behavior of algorithms leads to many new fundamental questions. How can we design algorithms that have good IO behavior? Can we argue that certain algorithms are optimal? How can we design efficient external memory data structures? Lars answered many of these questions during his time as a PhD student and also later when he moved to Duke University in the United States. His research resulted in many influential and highly cited papers. When he returned to Aarhus University after his time in the US, he continued to be a very productive researcher. He also founded Madalgo, a research center that brings together researchers from Aarhus University, MIT, the Max Planck Institute, and Goethe University Frankfurt. Madalgo has become the world-leading research center in the area of massive data algorithmics. The topic of Lars's research fits very well with the research being done in the data science center that we have here in Eindhoven. Moreover, his research philosophy fits very well with the philosophy of the TUE. To make progress on important scientific, industrial, and societal problems, we need fundamental research. And fundamental research needs to be inspired by important problems. This philosophy is visible not only in Lars's own work, but also in his research center, Madalgo. The research of Lars and others at Madalgo not only has produced novel foundational results, but the developed techniques are also applied to problems from geography and from ecology. For instance, Lars had worked extensively on simulating water flows on terrains, which makes it possible to predict the risk of floods after heavy rainfall. Using the theory he developed, he has shown how to do such large-scale flow simulations with just a standard laptop, sometimes speeding up the computation time from weeks to only hours. Lars takes the application of theory even one step further. He not only produces exciting scientific results, he also transfers these results to the market through his successful company, Skalgo. Given all these achievements, it is not surprising that Lars already achieved multiple awards and that he has held many prestigious positions. Let me just mention a few. He has been knighted by the Queen of Denmark. He has been elected into the Danish Academy of Technical Sciences and into the Royal Danish Academy of Sciences and Letters,
where currently he actually serves as the General's Secretary General. I'm very happy that the TUE today adds another honor to this impressive list. As I mentioned earlier, the honorary doctorate is also very special for me personally. I've known Lars for about 25 years already, and I've had the pleasure of collaborating with him on several occasions. These collaborations are always fruitful and inspiring, and in fact, my most cited paper is a joint paper with Lars and with Herman Havrecourt, a colleague from Eindhoven who is also here in the audience. The collaborations, I must add, were not only very successful scientifically, but they're always also a lot of fun. And I guess the local beer brewers usually profited quite a bit from our work. Besides these ties between us personally, there are several former PhD students from my group that later become postdocs at Madalgo. I'm looking forward to further strengthening the ties, both personally and between the Data Science Center Eindhoven and the Madalgo Research Center. Congratulations on this well-deserved honor.
I request the audience to rise during the pronunciation by the honorary promoter of the formula conferring the honorary degree.
By virtue of the authority given to us by law and on behalf of the doctorate board, I hereby award to you, Professor Lars Allan Arge, the degree of Doctor Honoris Causa. On account of your achievements in the field of algorithms for massive data and for your outstanding achievements in the design of IO-efficient data structures, I grant you the prerogatives belonging to the degree of doctor. In witness thereof, I present you the certificate signed by the Rector Magnificus and the honorary promoter and marked with the seal of Eindhoven University of Technology. In addition, you receive the kappa that befits a doctor honoris causa.
Please be seated. I invite Professor Arge to come forward for his speech.
Dear fellow researchers, students, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, let me thank Mark for the very nice words just before. And let me also thank TU Eindhoven for awarding me this honorary degree. I'm really honored and thrilled to receive this recognition. As Mark mentioned, my collaboration with Eindhoven researchers go back many, many years. I've enjoyed this collaboration tremendously, and it has actually played an important role in my personal career and in the success of my research center, Madalgo. Not only have we obtained some very strong results together, but as Mark mentioned, several Eindhoven master and PhD students have later gone on and become PhD students and postdoc at my center, Madalgo. One of these students, Frederik van Veldaveen, has actually stayed in Denmark and is now a very central employee in our startup company, Skalgo. I'm afraid to say that the Netherlands actually lost a very strong brain there. And I know from Frederik's mom that she certainly did not see it coming. But maybe it has something to do with a nice Danish girl also. I also hope I've contributed a little bit the other way Herman Havakot, as Mark mentioned before, was actually one of my very first postdocs. And as Mark mentioned, we obtained some very nice results together. So again, overall, I've really enjoyed and benefited tremendously from the working with Eindhoven and Dutch researchers over the years. Because I think, as you all know, it's not just about data, data, data. It's just as much about people, people, people. I think research philosophy, as Mark also mentioned, has a lot to do with the successful collaboration we've had. The dual focus on theoretical algorithm research and on practical motivations and applications of this research is certainly something we share. I think such a focus will be extremely important in the area of data science. And I think data science-centered Eindhoven has the right interdisciplinary setup to really promote and benefit from this. So I'm looking forward to speaking at the center tomorrow. So thanks again for not only for the honorary degree, but also for all the collaboration and fun we've had over the years. I'm really looking forward to intensifying the collaboration and continuing the fun. Thank you.
I have the honor to congratulate you, Professor Arge, on behalf of the Doctorate Board, the Executive Board, and the whole community of the Eindhoven University of Technology. And I invite you to take your seats again. This brings us to the end of this meeting, and I have the pleasure to invite you to the reception. Probably Jan and I have to skip the reception because we obviously have some work to do. So I hope to see you later at the university.
Is your job.